Well, once more, I welcome you to this Schiller Institute conference, which could not take place at a more appropriate moment, because we are presently confronted with the possibility of the disintegration of the global financial system. And as the subject of this conference is also the celebration of the 30th anniversary of the implementation of the SDI, or announcement of the intention to implement by President Reagan on the 23rd of March 1983, we are confronted with an existential danger to civilization. And therefore, I would really emphasize that the continued existence of civilization depends on two preconditions. One is the immediate, and I really mean immediate, that is in the next days or maximum weeks, implementation of Glass-Steagall. And the second condition is to finally implement the strategic defense of the Earth in the tradition of the SDI. Now, both subjects will be featured on this conference, the first SDI question in the morning panel, and we will deal with the fight to get Glass-Steagall through in the United States in the afternoon. But let me speak to the first point. Not so much in the American media, and I glanced through the internet headlines this morning, the Cyprus issue is not as prominently featured as it should be. But I can assure you that the international financial banking community right now is at the state of total panic. We could have a collapse of the system by Monday. We could have a run on the banks in starting, maybe not in Cyprus, but maybe in the neighboring countries, and this could spread to the global financial system. Because what has happened is that the worst possible accident took place, namely that by a loss of nerves or by design to bring down the system, I really don't know, but Mrs. Merkel, the Chancellor of Germany, did something which is about or has already triggered a confidence crisis in the banking system. Namely, she agreed and her government agreed together with the Troika of the EU Commission, the EZB and the IMF to commit theft against the small depositors of Cyprus. Now, this is a crime because not only is it thievery, this is threatening the confidence in the banking system. Remember that in 2008, after the collapse of Lehman Brothers and the collapse of AIG, and for a certain period, you know, everybody thought the system is coming down. There was a willingness to talk about the need to have the implementation of the new Bretton Woods. And the only reason why a banking run at that time could be prevented is because Chancellor Merkel made a bold statement by saying that she and her government would guarantee small depositors their deposits up to a level of 100,000 euro. And that sort of helped to reinstitute confidence. People believed that and so forth. And that was true until the Cyprus crisis broke, and for reasons which we have to leave to the historians to figure out why this actually happened, they insisted to impose a haircut on the small depositors of 6.75% and on the large depositors over 100,000 of 9.9%. But basically, you know, people now know that the money they bring to the bank is not safe there, but it can be taken by governments. Now, I mean, the banking system is based on trust. If people bring money to the bank, they have to be confident that it is safe. But if they have to fear that the government can take it, well, then naturally people think, well, how do I get my money as quickly out of the bank as I can? And that is then leading to a run. And given the fact that no bank has as much actual capital as they have, you know, promised or have deposits in them, you know, everybody thinks if I don't get first there, then I will lose my money, and that is then leading to a panic. And that could happen on Monday, because maybe not in Cyprus, because there they will try to make capital control, but it could happen in Italy, it could happen in Greece, in other countries which are in a not very different situation. And what then could happen, you get a taste of what happened in Albania in 1997 when the pyramid scheme collapsed and all the groceries closed, all the banks closed, people were storming food stores, but they also were storming weapon depots, and you could see little boys of 6 years old running with Kalashnikovs around. And the army robbed two because they had wanted to eat two. So it took weeks to reinstall order. And this is now possibly threatening at the whole transatlantic region, because if it spreads, you know, don't think that American banks will be not affected. Now, this is a breaking point, because, you know, the reach of this is gigantic. The euro is about to collapse. Remember that the head of the EZB, Draghi, had promised he would do everything to save the euro, meaning buying bonds without limit. And now Cyprus is not such a case where this applies. Now, obviously, Cyprus is a very delicate question because a lot of the foreign investors are Russian. And a lot of geopolitics obviously went into this decision to do it this way. In any case, Prime Minister Medvedev basically said, look, this is like the Soviet Union Politburo, who also did not care about the savings of the people. Now, this is now a situation where the mobilization, many of you have been involved in the last weeks, and especially coming here to Washington, trying to impress on the Congress that they have a historical responsibility to implement Glass-Steagall. You have a sense of what it takes, and I can only say the historic mission you are engaged in right now is of world historical importance to save civilization. Because for a variety of reasons, I don't think that the European countries will be able to solve this problem on their own. Because the EZB will try to impose a banking union, a political union, which will not function because the people of Europe, especially Southern Europe, have already emotionally and psychologically exited the euro a long time ago. So what is in danger, or what is the danger, is chaos. Now, the historical responsibility lies in the United States because of the tradition of Glass-Steagall, of the example of Franklin D. Roosevelt ending the Great Depression in 1933 with Glass-Steagall, means that the United States is the one place where the change can occur. And I think we have to go into an absolutely unprecedented mobilization following this conference to get the US Congress to implement Glass-Steagall. Now, this is not the only danger, because as we have all experienced on the 15th of February of this year, when the coincidence occurred of the asteroid flying by and a meteoric shower over the Urals, which nobody had anticipated, this brought home very, very clearly the danger our planet is confronted with, namely that, you know, objects from near space could hit the planet, and presently our civilization is not prepared to deal with that. And with the present budget cuts and sequestration and austerity programs, we will never be in a position to develop the kinds of technologies which are needed for that. So Glass-Steagall has everything to do with the SDI question, because if we don't get a new financial system and a new credit system, the means will not be there to defend the Earth against this danger. Now we have today, and that's why we choose this date for this conference, the date where President Reagan, 30 years ago, declared in a TV address the SDI to be the official American policy. Now, this was a historical opportunity which was really unbelievably great, and it came as a result of my husband, Lyndon LaRouche, and some others having responded to the fact that the world was in the middle of the middle-range missile crisis, where the warning time was so short that, you know, the danger existed to have an accidental launch, and the world was sitting minutes away from the danger of thermonuclear extinction. Now, when my husband proposed the SDI, we were involved for 1 year in negotiations with the Russians, with agreement from the Reagan administration. And, you know, there was the possibility to change the paradigm of the world completely. This was then rejected because the Russian government, after a change in the government, rejected it. But still, you know, what Lin proposed in the form of a new protocol for the superpowers, which was the idea that, you know, you would completely overcome nuclear weapons by implementing weapons based on technologies based on new physical principles, and that would become a science driver, not only in the military field, but in the civilian area. And Lin at that point had proposed practically an overcoming of the blocks, of the military blocks, and to use the science driver impact on the productivity of the civilian economy to launch a gigantic technology transfer program for the overcoming of the underdevelopment of the developing sector. Now, if that would have been done, we would have moved the world from a completely irrational, geopolitically oriented system to a new paradigm, which would have focused on what Dr. Teller at that time called the common aims of mankind. Now, we have now a situation 30 years after the Soviet Union did collapse, as Lin predicted in 1984, where he said if the Soviet Union continues to refuse this, they will collapse in 5 years. At that point, nobody believed that, but the Soviet Union did disintegrate starting with 1989 and finally in 1991. And then rather than using this historic moment where an opponent no longer existed to develop a new peace order for the 21st century, the neocons at that point decided to build an Anglo-American empire and eliminate every government in opposition through regime change. And that policy has continued to the present day. And unfortunately, the present NATO strategy is what was revealed in a recent article in the Quarterly Review Journal, basically the idea that it would be possible to take out the nuclear forces by an opponent by disarming and destroying their nuclear weapons, that supposedly nuclear weapons would have been modernized in such a way, and there would have been such a change in military technology that in a revolution in accuracy, so that with very accurate delivery systems and new renaissance technologies, one could take out the nuclear weapons of an opponent without without radioactive fallout. Now, this is the kind of thinking which will lead to World War III in the short term if it is not replaced. So, therefore, what we have to think about is we need a complete new paradigm shift. We need a completely different thinking where all nations of this world, especially the major nations of this world, have to put their forces together for a joint defense of the planet, because the technologies we need to defend against asteroids and other objects coming from space are principally the same technologies we need for a joint missile defense. Now, the possibility that we can pull the world together is absolutely there. We have been campaigning for Glass-Steagall in the last years in Europe. Just now, a very important group in Russia has put out a paper demanding for Russia a change to a Glass-Steagall-type credit system like Roosevelt did it in 1933. There are various proposals by the Russians for joint missile defense. And while there is a perceptiveness, but you know, the world is literally hanging by a thread. So the option is there that we can have a new paradigm, but you know, it's very far from certain. What we need is a renaissance thinking. We need people to agree that only a new paradigm, which is in coherence with the dignity and the true identity of mankind, namely that mankind is the creative species, the only one so far known in this universe, and that we have to completely revolutionize our thinking in the same way like Nicolaus of Cus proposed it in the 15th century when he said we need a completely new thinking. And indeed, his writings then marked the difference between the Middle Ages and what became to be known as modern times. So we have to make that shift. We have to make the shift from, you know, a world which is thinking in terms of conflict resolution through war and other means. If we don't get beyond that, we will not make it as a species. So, you know, we are at a moment which is totally pregnant with tension, you know, but I think this tension must be brought to, you know, a new age of civilization. And I want to tell you that all of you here in this room and those people who are participating in other ways in this conference, you are the ones from whom it largely depends. So with that, I want to open this conference one more time and give the word to Jeff Steinberg, who is the counterintelligence editor of EIR, who will speak about the history of the SDI and the need of SDE today.